Out there is a little known city within a city. Albatropolis is a small part of London, named after one of my most illustrious forebears, Prince Albert, whose innovation and original thinking helped to transform this part of Kensington.
The Science Museum, the Victorian Albert Museum, the Royal Albert Hall, the Imperial College of Science, the Natural History Museum, the Royal College of Music were all inspired by Queen Victoria's consort, which is the key reason why the Albert Memorial is here.
Considering Prince Albert only lived in the country for a mere 20 years, this area of Kensington is a truly remarkable testament to his imagination and energy. Yet there is no evidence of the one idea from which all this stems, the Great Exhibition of 1851. The concept was both revolutionary and highly controversial. Even now, it's difficult to imagine that they really proposed building a giant iron and glass conservatory in this part of Hyde Park and then turning it into the greatest trade show the world had ever seen.
Initially, though, the idea was greeted with a great deal of opposition. People expected the event would turn the park into an ideal venue for pickpockets, thieves, and all manner of petty criminals. That's partly because at one stage the area was a notorious haunt of highwaymen and robbers. The threat of being attacked was so great, even in 1689, that King William III had 300 lanterns hung from the trees along this route, and it became the first road in England to be lit at night.
It's also known as Rotten Row, although the name of this famous walk has nothing to do with crime or criminals, but is derived from Route du Roi after William III, who had it built privately. It took him from Whitehall Palace, the old home of the court, through Hyde Park to his new residence at Kensington.
Up until the late 19th century, Kensington was basically a village and regarded as a healthy retreat from the grime of London. This was one of the main reasons that royalty came to live here. In doing so, Kensington was totally transformed from a rural outpost to the centre of court life.
The principal palace at that time was the Palace of Whitehall, which is a huge building. And William and Mary, when they came to the throne, that was their main residence. Very damp. So it's very bad for William, who was an asthmatic. It's very bad for Mary, who was claustrophobic. She said on one occasion, "Here I am, surrounded by walls and water." So looking for somewhere else. They want a country residence near to Whitehall. And they bought what was then known as Nottingham House, which was, you know, in the pleasant village of Kensington. It was a Jacobean house, modest, like a number of ones around here, and really unsuitable for the king and the queen and their court. So Christopher Wren enlarged it and basically put four pavilions, one at each corner, and later on added the king's gallery and then the queen's gallery. And it just gradually enlarged until it was a bit like Topsy, it just grew.
Both William and Mary were afflicted with bad health, and it was thought that the good air of Kensington would be beneficial. But still, the palace echoed to the sounds of incessant coughing. At times, it seemed William kept himself going on sheer willpower.
But although the king's health was hardly good, it was the queen whose condition gave greater cause for concern.
Mary was only 32 when she contracted smallpox. Her death greatly affected the royal household. In her last few days, the king did not want to leave her side and even moved a small camp bed into her bedroom so that he could be with her all hours of the day and night.
When she died, the king collapsed from nervous exhaustion. He could not stay at the palace any longer and locked himself away at his house on Richmond Green. The king was to continue to rule alone for the next 8 years, until his own death at the palace. He was convalescing from a broken collarbone after a fall from his horse at Hampton Court. He used to sit by the open windows looking out over the gardens, and one day fell asleep. The chill he caught led to pneumonia, from which he never recovered. Fastened by a black ribbon to the king's arm, they found a curl of Mary's hair in a locket. Sadly, it was removed and not buried with him.
Anne was a proclaimed queen and came to live here at the palace, which by now was seen as the official residence of the monarch. She spent many long, contented hours in the company of her close friend, Sarah Churchill, Duchess of Marlborough.
Anne had been captivated by the young Duchess since they were children. She admired her vitality and toughness. When Sarah was made mistress of the robes and keeper of the privy purse, she was also given large apartments at Kensington. The women would spend many hours chatting together here in the Queen's closet. Queen Anne and Sarah Churchill took on assumed names. This allowed them to correspond through letters with an informality not usually seen between Queen and courtier. Anne called herself Mrs. Morley and Sarah Mrs. Freeman. But this intimate friendship was to come to a very bitter end.
Politics and everything else came into play. I suspect also Sarah got ever so slightly bored with the Queen. And eventually, other people became favourites at court. Sarah was gradually sort of frozen out. And eventually, desiring to sort of bring the matter to a head, she tracked the Queen down here, and they had their final quarrel in this building. Not so much a quarrel in the sense of a shouting match, because the Queen sort of sat there, and Sarah said, well, what's going on? Why don't you speak to me? And the Queen would say virtually nothing. And eventually, Sarah made a big mistake, got up and left. Which she shouldn't have done at all, because that was it, and never spoke again, and perhaps one of the most famous and important friendships in our history had finished.
In 1714, Queen Anne died at the palace. She had a stroke which was thought to have been brought on by overeating. The Queen had grown so stout that by her death, they had to build a huge, almost square coffin.
Anne had no immediate heirs, for her son William had died shortly after his 11th birthday. So she was succeeded by her second cousin, George, Elector of Hanover. There were 57 other people who had a better claim to the throne, but he was the first Protestant. As George I, he set about trying to improve the palace and engaged the artist William Kent to repaint the grand staircase and to include members of the court.
Probably the most unusual is the bizarre character Peter the Wild Boy, who was found in 1725 in woods near Hamelin in Hanover. Peter was thought to be about 13 years old. He walked on all fours, climbed trees with the agility of a squirrel, and ate grass and moss. Peter was presented to the king, who brought him to England. He was exhibited as a curiosity and allowed to roam the palace gardens. Although all attempts to civilize him failed, he outlived the king by nearly 60 years. William Kent was responsible for much of the painting at the palace under George I. He got the work by undercutting Thornhill, who was the official royal painter. Although many alterations and improvements were made, it was his son George II who made the palace one of his principal residences. It was while living here that the king met one of his neighbours. Lady Sarah Lennox was walking through the gardens with her governess when she saw the king. Though a mere child, she ran up to him and addressed him entirely in French. The king was so charmed by her that she was regularly invited to the palace to amuse him.
The young Sarah Lennox grew up here at Holland House. The house, and indeed this particular area of London, is named after Lord Holland, who lived here during the 17th century, at about the time of the Civil War.
Lord Holland's fatal characteristics was a tendency to vacillate, and of course Civil War was a perfect opportunity to do this. Although primarily a royalist at heart, obviously belonging to the nobility, he also was quite keen to keep his head, so he also was trying to favour the parliamentarian side as well. And he tried to play both sides off against one another. Unfortunately, this wasn't very successful, and he was beheaded in 1649.
The Roundheads took over Holland House for a while. Oliver Cromwell met one of his principal soldiers, General Ayrton, here to discuss the problems of the nation. Ayrton was so deaf, and Cromwell had to shout so loudly, that he conducted the meetings while walking around the grounds to prevent eavesdroppers. There is one strong feature from the time of the Civil War at Holland House. Lord Holland's widow, Lady Isabel, enjoyed staging theatrical events, even though it was against the strictly Puritan ethos. There is still a theatre today in the park, perched in the ruins of the old Holland House. It was during a performance at this theatre that the King's grandson, the Prince of Wales, and future George III, saw Sarah Lennox perform and was said to have fallen madly in love. But Sarah was fated not to become queen.
Meanwhile, the Prince of Wales's mother, Augustus, decided to take control of proceedings. She decided on Princess Charlotte of Mecklenburg. His marriage was arranged, and the course of true love was to be dashed. The irony is, of course, that historians now believe the marriage between George and Charlotte to be one of the most successful of all royal marriages.
Kensington Gardens was greatly improved by George II's wife, Queen Caroline, who expanded the palace's grounds and formed the Round Pond and Long Water. The Round Pond was created to keep turtles in, possibly for members of the court to eat. The Serpentine was also dug out to make into a feature. The king enjoyed taking early morning strolls around the gardens, and it was while on one of these solitary walks that he was robbed. A man jumped down from the wall of the garden and approached the king. With the greatest respect, he told the king how distressed he was that poverty had driven him to steal. He then politely demanded the king's possessions. The king gave him his money, watch, and the buckles on his shoes. He then asked the man if he could keep the seal which was attached to his watch chain. The robber agreed to return it the next day, as long as the king told no one about the incident. The man kept his word and returned at the arranged hour, and the thief handed back the royal seal intact.
Today, the park is used for all sorts of events and celebrations, for firing of salutes and concerts. However, the biggest event in the park's history is still the Great Exhibition, which was held in 1851.
It arose from the activities of the Royal Society of Arts, and probably Henry Cole was the man who was giving most of the push there. He joined it in the 1840s, and they had a series of small exhibitions of modern products. And it was out of those exhibitions that the great big exhibition of 1851 developed. Cole and his group of people on the committee of the Society of Arts convinced Prince Albert that it was a good thing, and then he gave the very important support from the top and used his influence with the government and other top people. And the new thing which Henry Cole and Prince Albert brought to it was that this exhibition was to gather works of industry from the whole world, so far as they could manage it.
At first, there was a public outcry when Queen Victoria gave permission for Hyde Park to be used as its site. People felt that the whole area would become a bivouac of all vagabonds. They were afraid that Kensington would become uninhabitable. A competition was held to find a design for the exhibition building, and 230 entries were received. Joseph Paxton won with a design based on a conservatory at Chatsworth House. Over 2,000 men were employed to construct a monumental building made from 4,000 tons of iron and 400 tons of glass, which incorporated the trees of the park. However, the building was overrun by a plague of sparrows, which no one could remove. They couldn't shoot them because of the glass. It was the Duke of Wellington who proposed a solution to the Queen. Dry sparrow hawks, ma'am. Once built, it was necessary to test whether the Crystal Palace could withstand the thousands of expected visitors. Squads of soldiers were marched in and ordered to jump up and down, shouting at the tops of their voices.
The Queen, of course, came to the official opening and several times beforehand to see how it was going. The British section was very highly organised with a classification system of 36 sections, ranging from everything from very heavy machinery to the products that people use in their ordinary life, china, stationery, clothes and so forth. And the them section, the foreign section, it was simply too difficult to arrange that within the 36 classifications, so each nation was given the amount of space it needed, and they showed all their stuff muddled up together.
When the exhibition closed 5 months later, it had been visited by over 6 million people. The following year, Crystal Palace was taken down and re-erected near Sydenham in South London. Sadly, it was destroyed by fire in 1936, but the area still takes its name. The exhibition was a huge success, and Albert was given the title of consort for his involvement with it. A profit of £186,000 was made, a huge and completely unforeseen fortune at the time.
Albert used the money to fulfill one of his dreams. He devised a concept for an establishment which would apply art and science to the industrial pursuits. The first thing he needed was a plot of land.
There were expanses of market gardens not far from the site of the exhibition in Hyde Park, stretching down the hill towards Brompton. And they decided to buy up a lot of land here. And that's the land on which the Victoria and Albert Museum now stands and the other museums of South Kensington. Prince Albert's idea was that this land would be a great cultural centre for London, and he wanted to group all sorts of cultural organisations on it. His first choice was the National Gallery, but the National Gallery wouldn't move, and that held things up for a number of years. The Albert Hall was a project like the Great Exhibition where public subscriptions were sought as the financial basis of the thing. And they were only able to get enough money by selling the rights to the seats and to the boxes.
Victoria bought 20 seats, which make up the present Royal Box. The commissioners for the 1851 exhibition, who were still the landlords of the hall, promised the site at a peppercorn rent of 1 shilling a year.
The hall was designed from the inspiration which Cole had taken from the Roman amphitheatres. Facing the Great Hall is a gilded memorial to Prince Albert, which was designed by George Gilbert Scott. The site of the memorial was carefully chosen. It stands on the bisecting point of two lines, one that runs through the site of the Great Exhibition and one that runs through the heart of Albertropolis.
The Queen took a close personal interest in the building of the memorial, and although rather strangely never expressed an opinion of the finished work, Scott was knighted for his efforts. Unlike the hall, though, the memorial never had an official unveiling ceremony.
Albert is shown reading a catalogue from the 1851 exhibition, with emblems and motifs of his influences and interests surrounding him. Victoria made rather a habit of renaming places she was asked to visit. In 1899, a new extension was needed for the South Kensington Museum, and the Queen laid the foundation stone.
It was one of the last official duties of her reign, and it seems appropriate that she chose to rename it the Victoria and Albert Museum. It was also her final opportunity to pay tribute to her beloved husband and their life together.
One of the main features Victoria would have seen when visiting the museum was the cast courts. These contained replicas of famous pieces of architecture and statues from around the world. They were assembled for the benefit of art students, who were seldom able to travel to the actual works themselves. A magnificent replica of Michelangelo's David still stands as it would have done at the time of Victoria's visit, the only difference being that he no longer wears a fig leaf. The leaf had been specially designed and added in order to avoid the Queen's embarrassment. There is another reason that Queen Victoria always had a special affection for Kensington. It was her birthplace and childhood home. She was born at Kensington Palace on the 24th of May, 1819. Her father died 9 months after her birth, and so she was brought up by her mother and by her governess, Louise Lazen, under a strict regime. Her life here was simple, consisting mainly of schooling, walking and family meals. She had a passion for ponies and would often be seen riding in a little trap through Kensington Gardens. Although she describes her childhood as lonely, she always had a great fondness for the palace.
As a young teenager, Victoria was made quietly aware of how close she was to the throne, when her mother inserted a page into a book on English kings and queens. It added the names of her uncles and then her own. When Victoria found the book, she is reported to have wept, raised a finger, and said, "I will be good."
It was to be 7 years before this was to become a reality. William IV died in the early hours of the 20th of June, 1837. The Archbishop of Canterbury, the Lord Chamberlain and the King's physician set out for Kensington. The Duchess was hesitant in waking her child, but agreed at 6 o'clock to bring her down to the sitting room.
It was into this room that the 18-year-old Victoria made her first entrance as Queen. She was still in her dressing gown when she received the news. She offered her hand to the Lord Chamberlain, who knelt down before her and kissed it, before gently informing her of her uncle's death. She then returned to her bedroom and put on a plain black dress. At 11:30 later that same morning, she held her first Privy Council meeting here at the palace to confirm her accession.
So imagine all the great and the good, the Prime Minister, her uncles, Duke of Wellington there. In fact, the Duke of Wellington described the scene. He said, when she came in, and she was, you know, literally a slip of a girl, and she dominated the proceedings completely. She had natural authority, whatever you want to call it, she had it in spades. And, you know, the Victorian age began here at that time. She commissioned a man called Wilkie to paint the accession council. And it's a very accurate reflection of the room, the Red Saloon here, and it has the looking glass in its position, has the Duke of Wellington, has the Prime Minister holding the first state paper she signed. One big mistake. Because they're all wearing dark colours, Wilkie put her in white, which she could have worn for mourning, but she actually wore black, and the dress survives, in fact, and she wasn't best pleased. You know, she could notice details, and she certainly noticed which colour she should be wearing.
By the time of Victoria's accession, Kensington was no longer the monarch's official residence. She was only to spend a couple more weeks at her childhood home before moving to Buckingham Palace. She records in her diary the sadness that she felt at leaving her poor palace. It had been a place with special memories, and none more so than her first meeting with Albert of Saxe-Coburg, which took place here in 1836. Now, of course, the palace is most closely identified with Diana, Princess of Wales, and the extraordinary events that followed her death in 1997. Even now, a day does not seem to pass without someone leaving a flower to pay tribute. The palace is still a royal home and is where Princess Margaret, the Duke and Duchess of Gloucester, and Prince and Princess Michael of Kent live.
The area of Kensington has many connections with the crown, but has been officially recognised for one in particular. In 1900, Queen Victoria was asked to confer the title Royal on the borough in recognition of this being her birthplace. Sadly, she died before it could be officially acknowledged. However, her heir, Edward VII, gave the go-ahead on her behalf, so Kensington became the first of only three royal boroughs in the country.